like let's say a stove, right? People like, people say, what are you gonna just let your kid, burn his hand in the stove? You got to hit him to make sure he doesn't. Like, well, I mean, you basically, you don't burn his hand, but you maybe you teach maybe you use that opportunity to teach him about fire. And actually, this is a good anecdote. My son, recently, since we go to these meetups with the other homeschooling families, we go in the woods and we cook. We make fire a lot, so he's around fire a lot, and he's become comfortable around fire. He's not scared of it, which is awesome. I love that. And even this other homeschooling family, this Russian family, they're around. Their kids are pretty proficient with knives. Like their kids are like 5 and 6. And they have like not like regular like small like tiny Swiss Army knives, but like a good nice like knife you get in a like a, I don't know, a knife store or a hunting knife,
Sure.
and they're pretty proficient, and you can see that they've done it and they're very confident about it, and their parents don't like intervene. Oh, careful, don't cut yourself. I mean, sure, they have cut themselves a couple times, but again, natural consequences. You learn, right? And the same thing with fire. You learn to respect the fire. And if you get burned once or twice, they're gonna learn to respect the fire. It's not something that you have to like beat into them. Respect the fire. No, they learn. And so my son, as a result of that, he's wanted to. We were at home, and he found some matches, right? And he took them out. And initially, like, he was like, "Ha ha! I have the matches." And he expected me to, like, I guess, take them away immediately. But I said, "All right, Marcus, we're gonna do it. We're gonna do it." On, let's say, the tile floor, right? And I mean, it was in the bathroom, but like, there was like a what do you call it, the floor mat, right? And so I said, and so for he did one, and he got really scared, and he dropped it, right? It lit up, and he got really scared, and he dropped it, and it did go on the what do you call it, the mat, and he just snuffed it out really quick, and I was like, all right, do it again, but this time hold on to the mat, don't drop the mat, don't be afraid of the fire, do it strong, strong. So he kept doing it until he was so confident, and so he loves it. And since then, he's been like sleeping with matches underneath his bed, underneath his pillow, and it kind of freaks out my parents, because we're living with them, so we got kind of into a little argument about it. But he was so confident about it that when his cousin, who was like 4, so my son is 5, when his cousin was 4 came over, he wanted to show. He's like, look, I can do the matches. Look, I'm very confident. And the problem was that my parents were home, so they knew that my son knew that my parents would disapprove, because before then, before my parents knew that we were doing this, my son w you know, I'd be at home with my kids, and my son would just get the matches and just do it on the tile floor, fine. And him and my daughter, they would just be doing it, having a lot of fun. He would light a match, they would just look at it and blow it out, and light another match, and they're having so much fun with it. And then, they knew my parents would disapprove, and so what they did was they went in the closet.
Oh.
And my younger the younger cousin, he when he lit the match, he like got really scared, he pushed it, and it dropped, but my son just like patted it out, and he did
Yeah.
another one, and what was funny was he was so confident with it that later he told me about that he actually got burned a little bit on his, because I noticed a red spot on his wrist, and he said he got burned with the fire. I'm like, did you got burned? Did you cry at all? No, it didn't hurt. It just amazed me how confident he was, and I loved that, and so that's one reason why he was so happy today when we went to the to see the homeschooling family. He's like, the first question, we're we gonna make fire? Yeah, we're gonna make fire. So it's just a matter of. Not immediately prohibiting them from doing activities that you think are dangerous, right? But just being there and helping them to do it, right? Because, like you said, they're gonna do it anyway. Like, if I say, no, don't touch those matches ever again, what do you think he's gonna want to do when I'm not around, right?
Yeah, he's gonna want to do
Ex
it.
of course, once they have the desire, the curiosity, you can't really extinguish that, It doesn't matter how much you beat them, how much you say no. You're not there all the time. You're not around them all the time. They're going to be by themselves. And so, you want them to feel confident that if they want to approach you or ask you a question about something, that they can do so and not fear that you're going to punish them for doing something that you think that you would disapprove of, And let me tell you another great example of something that my wife did recently. She got a new tower for her computer, and immediately my son was very interested. And so what she did was she opened up the tower, and she was explaining every single thing inside the computer. Like, this is the motherboard, this is the memory drive, this is the RAM, this is the fan to keep the computer cool, this is the USB port, this is for the internet, this is for the power supply. And he was intrigued. He was really mesmerized by the whole thing, the complexity of the inner workings of a computer. And then, you know, she covered it up, and then frequently he was like, can you open the computer again and show me again? Like, he was so excited about it. I thought that was such an awesome thing. I just love it when kids, they get so excited about learning something new, you know? And I was so happy to see my wife doing that, because you could just see that his eyes lit up. Like, this is something new to learn about, right? And I think that's what it's so important for us to maintain. And this is what I was telling those 16-year-old girls in the library, is that it doesn't matter what the kids learn, right? Fundamentally, it does not matter what they learn. It doesn't matter what facts they learn, how many words, how good their English is. If they hate learning, you have failed, right? Because a love of learning, self-motivation, self-education will get them very far in life. You know, there's, you know, if you have a desire for learning and you're like, I can work on the job, I can learn whatever you want me to learn, I can do this, you know, there's nothing they can't do, you know. And so all you have to do is just maintain that love of learning, and they can go anywhere with that, you know. They can do anything. So so that's my focus.
Yeah, I think that's awesome. And to speak on how letting a kid do something like play with fire, you know, allows them to become proficient and learn the dangers of it. Like, I've got a couple buddies who, you know, all they did was play around with guns and fire, and now, like there's nobody else that I would trust more than those two.
Yeah, right.
Right. To be able to do stuff, right? Because they just know how it works. They know how to control a fire,
right?
Because they've done it so many times. Mm-hmm. And like, for me, I just didn't, and I kind of wish I did more as a kid. And I don't contribute that to my parents so much. I don't remember why I didn't get out to do so much as a kid. I think I was just kind of I was shy, and I was kind of a little chicken a lot of the time. I don't know exactly why that was. Oh. Maybe it was because my parents didn't let me do enough. But it seems like I know I've been out in the garden for forever. So I have no idea. But, you know, I feel disappointed that I didn't do that. Right. But I learned how to deal with knives when I was fairly young. And now, yeah, I have them all the time, and I can be safe with them. And like, my parents taught me, well, don't cut towards you, Nick, because you'll stab yourself. And they explained why. And I did it a couple times. And of course, I cut my thumb.
Right.
So now I don't do that.
Right, exactly.
Unless I'm being very careful, right? But no, I love that point that kids can learn on their own. And it's nice if they have somebody who's encouraging them alongside them, like what you're doing with your son. Like, yeah, show him how to use a match and watch him, so that you can provide some input if he desires it or if he needs it, right? So I think that's excellent.
Yeah. It was a little bit unnerving to my parents when they did find out, because because they came home and my father was like, why are there used matches on the floor? Because after he was finished, I'm like trying to clean them all up quickly. All right, quick, before my parents come. But I guess I missed a few, and so they found them. So. But yeah, it's really vital to you know, to maintain that. And you know, one thing that, you know, I didn't grow up in with is you know, a comfort with weapons and, you know, guns and knives, which that's one thing that I have to remedy with myself. You know, the more I learn about voluntarism and anarchy, you know, you're around these people. There's a lot of gun lovers, which is awesome, because it's just another skill. You know, it's just another skill to learn and how to be safe. And so I want to learn that, and I want to teach my kids not only for self-defense, you know, like, you know, I think they ought to learn martial arts if they want to. but I also want to teach them, yeah, about how to defend themselves with weapons, you know, knives or guns or whatever, because, you know, it's so important for them to feel safe, right? For, you know, wherever they go. And actually, there's a friend of mine, Melissa Rakovic, who we're going to start a peaceful parenting podcast. I think we're going to call it the non-aggressive parenting podcast. Like, it's a play on the NAP, non-aggressive parenting.
Okay, that's good.
And so she has a 3.5-year-old and like a 17-month-old. And so, and they're big gun users, gun lovers. And so one thing that's kind of interesting that she told me, which I had not considered, was because she grew up with guns and she's very familiar and comfortable with them, they both made this agreement that they will not buy toy guns for her kids because she does not want them to think of guns as being toys, which is a very interesting idea. I had not considered that. Approaching it for that angle, it's like you want to teach them to respect guns, then you don't say that they're toys. You know, you say that they're very powerful things that can do damage if you want them to, but and they must be respected. You know, like anything, like a car, like, you know, you teach your kid to respect the car. Like, you can, somebody really, you know, crazy behind the wheel can do a lot of damage, you know, just as much as a gun, but people tend to like vilify guns more. And it's such a weird thing, you know, vilifying an inanimate object. I always found such a weird. It's your fault, you know. Like, I love those memes where like they say, you know, I left my gun outside, it didn't shoot anybody, I was amazed. You know, I woke up, nobody was dead on my front porch. I was just amazed, nothing happened, you know. but yeah, so that's one thing I want to remedy, is learn how to shoot and teach my daughter, because you know, like they say, because a restraining order is just a piece of paper, right? And and you know, I would rather my daughter you know, have to explain why, you know, there's a hole in her would-be rapist's chest rather than, you know, why she got raped or assaulted or you know, mugged or anything like that. So
yeah.
So it's about being confident and knowing how to defend yourself, and that's it. So
yeah, exactly. I recently started taking martial art. I'm taking Brazilian jiu-jitsu.
Nice.
And it's so fun. I'm unfortunately not really I'm not at a gym that's focusing on self-defense, but it's a small class, so I decided, okay, I'm gonna stay with it and learn some of the basics, and then maybe switch to somebody that's focused more on self-defense. But I think it's a very valuable skill, and it's just fun. I guess that's just all I wanted to say, but I wanted to move on too, unless you have any thoughts on that too. I don't want to move fast.
Well, I just wanted to say one more thing I just thought of on the topic of, you know, forcing your kids to learn things, is that I was forced to learn karate as a child for 8 years. I did karate. And maybe like the first year I probably enjoyed it, but then after that I quickly hated it because I was just forced to be there's no choice whatsoever. And then I got up to brown belt 3 stripes, and then I could have got my black belt, but my father finally gave me the opportunity to stop, and I did. I took it immediately. I didn't look back at all. And you know, the same thing goes with anything that parents are proficient in. Like for example, me, right? I love playing piano, I love playing chess. You know, I'm an acupuncturist, Chinese herbalist. And so when I talk to people, they're like, oh, of course. Oh, nice. So your kids are going to learn chess and piano and how to do acupuncture and herbs. And you know, that's such a natural thing for people to – that's such a natural conclusion for them to come to. And then I have to say, no, actually, I'm not going to teach them if they don't want to learn, right? I'm going to show them that I love to do acupuncture and I love to do piano and I love to play chess. Do it, and I do. I play chess a lot around my kids, and my daughter is interested in it. My son does know the basics; he's interested. But I don't sit them down and say, "Now we're going to learn chess," or "Now we're going to learn piano." Don't move. Sit still. Pay attention. Like, what better way to destroy their love of learning of anything than doing that? You know. And I know. And let me just say real quick. I was treating the some piano players in this university near me. For their, you know, for their forearm problems, and one of them, who's PhD, she was taking her PhD in piano studies at the time. She said she started learning when she was 3 years old, right? And I started learning piano when I was 12, and most people would say that's way too late. But I started because I had a passion for it and I wanted to learn it. I loved it. I had a burning desire. I'm like, I want to learn this. It's so awesome. And I did. And I practiced so hard. Like, I would wake up like 4:30 in the morning, practice an hour before school, go to school, come home, practice 2 hours after school, Monday through Friday. Like, I loved it. And I got good. And I was really, and I was pretty good. And that was because I loved it, not because someone told me to do it. You know, self-motivation goes such a long way, right? And it doesn't matter what it is, what you think your children should learn. It doesn't really matter to me. If they're not motivated to do it, it's all in vain. They're not going to do it. And not only that, but you risk them hating you for it and hating that particular thing. Like,
right.
Like if I taught them, forced them to learn piano, maybe they're going to end up hating piano music for the rest of their lives. And why would I want to risk that? Right.
So, mm-hmm.
Aside from it being a violation of consent.
Sure. I mean, that's yeah, that makes a whole lot of sense to me. And the thoughts that's popped into my head listening to that is the way I got into politics and actually even chess too, was watching my grandfather and my great uncle and my dad talk about it. I thought, well, that's kind of neat. And the same thing with chess. You know, they would play chess sometimes. And they probably said, hey, Nick, come here, learn this. And I was like, well, okay. You know, I don't remember when they taught me how to play chess, but you know, it's just something I enjoy. And it's kind of interesting is that the main thing in my life that I've been doing is studying politics and philosophy. And I didn't come to that because my dad's like, hey, Nick, watch the news with me or pay attention to what I'm doing. It right. came from me asking him questions like,
exactly.
Well, why are you voting for Bob Barr? And he told me why.
Yeah.
And so that's how I got into it. So that's just kind of neat and thinking about that. But, you know, it makes a lot of sense, it seems to me. And I'm sure people are objecting to it. I'm trying to think of, well, why and how are they objecting to it so we could maybe address it? But I just don't understand it. So I don't know. You know,
yeah.
And it just seems very obvious to me that of course, people aren't going to enjoy something that they're forced to do.
Yeah, I know. It just seems so self-evident to us, right?
Right.
Like, well, of course you're not going to force somebody. Like, why would you ever do that? And that also goes back to the idea of never shutting down a child's questions, right? Because
mm-hmm.
that's when true how do you say, interest in something surfaces. You know, that's when their mind is open and receptive to new information. And like, you know, when you asked your father about the politics, you know, your mind was open. You were ready to receive it. You know, if your father said, sit down, you're not ready to receive it. You're not going to pay attention. And maybe because he said that or because he forced you to sit down and watch the news or something, you're going to be even more repelled by it. And you know, your life would have taken a very vastly different turn maybe, you know?
Right. Yeah, exactly. And I think it's pretty obvious. And I think if anybody doubts that, then think about when you've had to sit down because somebody made you. You know, did you enjoy that situation? And did you, you know, what was your reaction? And explore that. I would really encourage people to do that. And then maybe it was you decided, well, maybe this is something good for me, and I really should do it. And you decide to do it. Hey, that's fine. But I think most of the time when you're forced to do stuff, you're going to have an emotional reaction, and that's going to last. It's going to make it less enjoyable for you.
Let me ask you. So how far, like how deep did you get into chess?
How deep can you go? What do you mean?
Okay. Let me tell you, let me tell you how deep I got into it. So my father taught me around 5 years old. Right. And, and I would play my father. I would play my grandfather. And my uncles, when they would visit, everybody would beat me. Everybody beat me. I thought my grandfather was like a grandmaster. He just seemed like mm-hmm. so smart. He's a PhD in like chemistry and mathematics. So he's just a learned guy. So I'm like, wow, this guy must be awesome in chess. He's probably a grandmaster. And then my epiphany, my intellectual, you know, awakening came when I was 12. That's when I started playing piano, and that's when I started really getting serious into chess. I don't know what happened, what clicked in my mind, but I'm like, I remember when I just woke up on a particular day, and I'm like, I told my father, I want to play you in chess. We played a game and we drew, and I even remember the specific position that we got into when we drew, and that was a turning point for me. And since then, I have been massively reading voraciously many chess books, And then I got into the computer. I was playing on internet chess clubs. I went to chess tournaments. You know, we were traveling to different internet chess tournaments. And I had a chess tutor for like a year. And I was, you know, along with the piano, I was also studying chess, you know, usually before school, reading my chess books and just learning about chess history. That's also another thing I was fascinated by, is chess history and all the world champions and all the different styles and everything. Mm-hmm. Fascinated me. But I just devoured all of this information. And since then, my father can't beat me. My grandfather can't beat me. None of my uncles can beat me anymore. They don't play me in chess. They don't play me in chess anymore. And I just loved it so much. I started the chess club in my high school that lasted from 9th to 12th grade. Because I asked, like, is there a chess club here? And they're like, no. All right, I'm going to start one. That's it. What do I have to do? I'm going to start a chess club now. So I started it, and I was so happy. And then when I met my wife in 12th grade, that was our first date. You know, I always tell people took her to the chess club. And then when I left, when I went back, I discovered it kind of dissolved and disbanded, because not many people were as interested or passionate about it as I was, which was fine. You know, I went to college, studied mm-hmm. my Chinese medicine, and guess what I did in college? I started another chess club in college. Can you imagine what's more like out of place, starting a chess club in a college where they're teaching massage therapy, acupuncture, and Chinese herbal medicine? But I'm like, I don't care. I want to start a chess club. So I did. But yeah, I've always been a loving chess. I went to like, you know, those hustlers in Washington Square Park in Manhattan play chess for money, you know. $2 a game, $5 a game, you know. I went there and I did that. I just loved it. And I still love it. I mean, of course it died down a little bit, but you know, I've taught, you know, I've had some students, and I've tried to open up chess meetings in my local library, and what, you know, one of them got kind of it died down because not many people were coming. But you know, if there's a chance that I can meet people to play chess, I will take it. I love it. And mm-hmm. and another library I discovered has a lot of kids that come there that come there like once every 2 weeks, and they're like around like 10 years old, that age, but they're interested in chess, and it's such an awesome environment. I love it. And I, you know, I love to teach people. Like, I don't like to just play people and like try my hardest to beat them as viciously as possible. That's no fun for me.
Sure.
What I like to do is turn that into a learning opportunity and say, do you know what you did wrong? You know, or go through the game and say, why did you do that move? You know, what was your reasoning behind that? And like, I don't know. Well, you know, you gotta have a reason. You don't just
Think about it.
You don't just move random pieces in chess. You know, you gotta have a reason. And so, you know, I love turning each game into a learning opportunity, because the way I look at it, you know, everyone wants to win. Like, I can beat you. But no, it's not about winning. It's about learning something, right? Because if I win, I don't learn anything. I didn't learn anything, because you can only learn things by being around people that are smarter than you, right? And so I forget who said this, maybe Bill Buper or something, but if you're the smartest person in the room, you're in the wrong room. get out of the room.
Uh-huh.
You know, so that's why I love to surround myself with really, you know, people who are just awesome, excellent in chess. And so, and I've learned a lot from them. And so I try to do that too. And I'm around, you know, other people. I don't just beat them for the sake of beating them, but be like, all right, let's go back. Let's examine this game. Because, you know, examining, you know, I can teach you from a chess book, like this grandmaster, how this grandmaster played and their style and strategy. And that's all in good. But in the end, learning how you play chess is a better indicator of your thought processes, and will do better in terms of learning how you can improve your game. So that's what I mean when I say, how deep did you get?
Not that deep.
Yeah. Not too many.
No.
But you know, I hear Tom Woods talk about chess a lot in his podcast, and I'm like, I want to play Tom Woods in chess. I want to see how good he is. And he says how he plays. Yeah. He plays Walter Block in chess. I'm like, I gotta go to these events so I can track him down. Bring my chessboard with me.
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Wouldn't that be great?
Yeah,
bunch of geeks and dorks. You know, well, we fit right in. You know,
talking about economics and chess.
Exactly. Perfect. The perfect surroundings. So yeah. So I will. So yeah, that's what I do. I play chess and I bring my kids with me, and they see and they watch, and sometimes they participate, and that's awesome. And you know, in their own way, you know, they're interested. So, you know, who knows where that's going to end up? And if they don't end up, you know, taking it as seriously as I did, you know, that's fine too, but they're exposed. So I'm fine with that.
Yeah, sure. No, that's awesome. And, you know, I can see a lot of correlation between, you know, your experience with chess and, you know, everybody has their different field of interest. And you can see that people become extremely proficient in what they want to become proficient at, unless they are discouraged from doing so for some reason.
Mm-hmm.
And it might be that somebody discourages themselves from doing something. And usually that's because they were discouraged at some point from doing something else too, right? So
or parents that just didn't support them in what right. whatever they wanted to do, and they just and so one meme I just say real quick, that you know, it says be careful how you talk to your child, because that will become their inner voice.
Exactly. Yes, that's exactly the point I was trying to make. That yeah.
Sorry, stole your thunder. Sorry.
It's no problem. Not a problem at all.
It's your show, you know. Sorry.
No, but so I appreciate that you saying that, because that's exactly, I wasn't going to phrase it as well as that. So,
well, it's a meme I read. You know, I can't take credit.
sure. But so that's the idea, I think, kind of behind peaceful parenting, though, right? Is you want to treat your kid in a respectful way, in a peaceful way, because if you don't, they're not going to be a respectful or peaceful person.
Yeah. And it also, I thought of another argument, basically saying how, well, you need to go to school because you need to get a basic education so that you can get a degree, or what do you call it, a diploma. And then you can take that diploma and go to a college and get a degree and then get a job, right? So you need that to go further, right? And so basically, when I explain to normal people like that are not versed in this kind of stuff, when I explain to that is like predicting the future, claiming you can predict the future, right? Because you're saying right. that the information children are learning now when they're starting public school is going to be applicable and necessary for them in 20 years. Or maybe 15 years when they leave or when they go through university, right? Mm-hmm. That's what you're saying. You're trying to predict the future. Now, go back to, let's say, 1994, right? Like, what's that, like 22 years ago. Those parents at that time told their kids, go to public school. You need to go to school. You need to learn this so you can get a job, so you can get a degree, and you know, be successful in life. So they're telling them what they need in 15 or 20 years in the future. Now, how many of those parents could have predicted YouTube, Wikipedia, Google, Facebook, Skype, right? How many could have predicted those things and how that has fundamentally transformed the landscape of how humans interact with each other and how we can communicate, how people make money online, you know? How many could have predicted that? Nobody, right? So how can you say that what these bureaucrats force kids to learn in their curriculum will be relevant to them in their future? You can't say that at all. Nobody knows the future. We don't even know what's going to happen next month, next year. How can you possibly say this is what you're going to need in 15 years? It's to me, it's the epitome of hubris to say that, right? Mm-hmm. And another analogy I like to use for people is it's like, imagine in the early 20th century when cars were just being developed, and parents were saying, you know, so cars were being developed, and the kids at that time were saying, well, I want to drive a car, and the parents were like, no, you have to learn how to ride a horse. Why? Because my parents rode horses and their parents rode horses. Everybody knows that. Well, there's now we have cars. We don't need horses. No. And it's like, it's just amazing how the you know, rigid, conformist, inflexible attitude of the previous generation, it seems like they always try to hold back the emerging technology of the next generation. and that will eventually render their generation obsolete and irrelevant.
Right.
Which is, I think the internet has done in a large part to so many mm-hmm. things, you know, like USPS, like, you know,
yes.
phones, like long term, what do you call that? You know, long distance phone calls, mm-hmm. like, mm-hmm. like the fax machine, like so many things have just been gone by the wayside. And it's just amazing that people accept that. They accept that, you know, iPhone's going to come out with a new iPhone. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be better, you know. But, you know, you're like, oh, but you still got to learn your presidents. You still got to learn right. what capital, you know, which state, the capitals of all the state. You still got to learn who won World War II. And it's so sad because it's like there's so much. If you just think about, like, go back in time and think about how many bits of information there exist in all of, like, recorded human history. And then how do you determine, like, this little sliver of information, this is what you need to know to be a functioning human being. This is what, this is necessary. How do you determine that? There's no, absolutely no way to determine that. Completely arbitrary, and really, I you know, I really think it has, you know, the information fundamentally has nothing to do with going to school. Really, the unwritten lessons that people learn in school is, you know, what you carry through from an authoritarian household is you are an inferior. Respect your superiors. Information comes down from the superiors. Obey or you get punished. You know, movement. You know, and I like to tell people, I send them the video. I don't know if you saw this video by Josie Wales, which is A Prison by Any Other Name. You heard of that video?
I haven't heard of that video.
Definitely check that out. I send that to every person who I, you know, I warm them up first talking about homeschooling. I don't send them that video first because it's kind of, it's a slap in the face, intellectual slap in the face. But basically saying how school is paralleled to prison in so many ways, you know, the people, the inmates long for freedom. mm-hmm. They constantly look at the clock. They have a limited amount of time for recess, you know. They mm-hmm. the movement is determined by bells and sounds, you know. There is a definite hierarchy in terms of, you know, who's the superiors and who's the inferiors. You know, in so many different ways. It's just yeah. So it's kind of chilling, but yeah.
All right. No, it's exactly right, and that's what I think. It's one of the best analogies for school, and it really is a prison, and nobody really enjoys it unless you're one of the people who can thrive in that situation. There are a few people who could and have, but it's a very small minority, and I guarantee you 99% of students don't enjoy school and don't want to go to school in the morning. You know, that's just the thing.
Yeah, exactly. It's like how many students, like when there's a snow day, they're like, oh man, I wanted to go to school today. Right? How excited, like you can see how excited kids get when there's a snow day over here. I guess you guys probably get a lot of snow days over there too, right?
Not a whole lot, but
okay.
It doesn't snow too much. Okay, we get more flood days than snow days.
Flood days. Ah, interesting. Okay. But yeah. Yeah, and if people question when they question to me the idea of compulsory education, you know, you're not forced to be there. It's what, because they keep telling me, like, why do you keep using this word force? I'm not comfortable with you using this word force. Why do you keep I'm like, okay, do you know what truancy laws and truancy officers are? This is what I tell people.
Yes.
And most people, well, I'm not asking you, I'm just saying this is what I tell people. I'm like, do you know what they do? And most people don't. Most people have no idea.
Right.
Or they're like, I never thought about that, you know? That those people are there to make sure you go to school. And if you don't, they will come to your house, they will fine your parents, or in drastic situations, maybe punish your parents or imprison your parents, you know? Because this is not a choice, right? This is compulsory education. If your parents concede to it, or, you know, if you don't concede, you know, you do homeschooling, you know, it doesn't really apply. But if you concede to it, you're in the system, then you must comply, you must obey. And once you peel back the thin veneer of decency that most people think of when they go to school, you can reveal the gun in the room that's present in every single government agency, you know, and it's very easy to peel that back and expose that. And I think as libertarians and voluntarists and anarchists, that's our job, is to help people understand that no, this, we live in a very uncivilized society that is very ancient and very barbaric, right? We still rule by force, and this is remnant of a very barbaric age, and this is actually holding us back. This is not helping us. So yeah, I think it's helpful sometimes to reveal that.
Yeah, no, I think you're exactly right. Yeah, I don't have anything to add there. We can go on for about, I don't know how long we've been recording, but the call's been an hour and a half. I try to keep it under an hour. But this was a fantastic conversation, Danilo. And I think we have more to even cover. So I would love to have a discussion like this again. Because sure. this was very fun. And I think we got a lot of awesome information out there. So thank you for joining me.
Yeah, definitely. And this is exactly why I want to start my own Peaceful Parenting podcast. And also we're going to talk about homeschooling, unschooling, because, you know, on the Seeds of Liberty, we occasionally touch on homeschooling, but not enough. Like, this is a vet, like, just like, you know, just the School Sucks podcast, right? They basically devote their entire podcast just to talking about, right, government school and homeschooling and, you know, different ways to learn, right, self-education. Mm-hmm. And it's just a vast topic that I think it deserves more focus, you know? And so I think that we will be delving into a lot of topics like this. And I definitely love to be on again. Thank you for having me.
Awesome. Yeah. And why don't you plug all of your sites and links?
Yeah. So you can find me on Facebook. My name, Danilo Cuellar, DanilocuellaR, Danilo Cuellar. And then my Facebook page is Peaceful Anarchism. And my Twitter is @PAnarchism. And my website is peacefulanarchism.com. And you can find my my podcast, my Peaceful Anarchism podcast on YouTube under Peaceful Anarchism, the username, as well as Stitcher and iTunes as Peaceful Anarchism. So please check me out and follow my work. If you like it, let me know what you think. I'm always interested in feedback because that's how we improve, right? People listening to our stuff and commenting, giving us feedback, you know, saying, you suck, I hate you, you know, all the ad hominems. Or, you know, you're doing an awesome job. So whatever, good or bad, it's always nice to have feedback. And actually, you know, I think we probably grow more from the negative feedback than from the positive because, you know, sometimes, you know, you need to be, you know, we all need corrections, right? We're all still learning. I think, you know, we could all use some constructive criticism. That's the key. Keep it constructive criticism. Just saying you suck and you're wrong does not count as being constructive criticism. I'm sure you can relate to that too, right?
Yes, yes.
So awesome. Thanks a lot. Yeah, I really appreciate the opportunity to come on your show.
Yeah, thank you.